turning back to John 14 now, and we had covered the first six verses, about which there was much to say, and there's plenty to say about the rest as well, though I think we'll move a little faster through the material tonight. Reading those verses again and beyond, let's start at the first verse. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions or dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, Show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these will he do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Now, in the Upper Room Discourse, Jesus has a number of themes that he revisits numerous times in chapters 14 and 15 and 16. One of those themes, of course, is the theme of his going away and coming again. He has brought it up in verse 3. He will bring it up again in verse 18. He says, I will not leave you orphans, I will come to you. He'll bring it up in verse 19. He says, a little longer, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. And likewise in verse 28, I am going away and coming back to you. So there's many references to his going away, and in each case with the promise that he'll return to them. Now this is, of course, the setting of this whole discourse. Jesus was soon to be taken from them. This was the night before his crucifixion. He was later this evening arrested and then crucified the next morning. And that being so, the disciples had to be apprised of the change in circumstances that they were going to be facing. And so he says, well, first of all, you're going to lose me, but you're going to gain me back. And the exact meaning of that, we will examine more when we get to verses 15 and following, because he seems to clarify it after that point. But there are other things he wants to tell them too. One of the things he's going to tell them is that they can pray using his name. And another thing he wants to tell them is that he's going to send them another comforter. These are some of the main themes that will come up in this chapter and which will be repeated numerous times in the remainder of the discourse. But before we get to some of those repeated themes, and we will in verses 12 and following, there is this section, verses 7 through 11, where he says, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Now, from now on, you have known him and seen him. Now, they had seen him already. They'd seen Jesus, and that's what he was talking about. Seeing him is seeing the Father. But they have not known that. They have seen him, but they have not known him. And from now on, you will know him and see him. You will know that the one you have seen is him. is he. And that is what he's saying, but they don't understand what he means. And so Philip says, well, Lord, just show us the Father and that'll be enough. That'll suffice. Because you've said we will have seen him from now on. So are you going to pull back the curtain and let us see the Father? Are you going to show us the Father? That'd be great. That's all we would need. That's all we could ever long for. That's sufficient for us. We'll be content. And the word sufficient means content. It's same, you know, when you find the word content in Scripture, it's the same word as for sufficient. Being content means you've got enough. You have no craving for more. You're satisfied with what you have. And so they say, we'll be content if you just show us the Father. And Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long? And yet have you not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Now, we have some of the strongest declarations of the deity of Christ right here. And if people thought that Jesus has not specifically said, I am the Father here, they nonetheless have to take into consideration what it is that Jesus is saying. He's saying, you want to see the Father? How long have I been with you and you don't know who I am? Now, that in itself, if he said nothing more than that, would be implying strongly that he is the Father, and a very blasphemous thing for any man to imply, unless he is. I mean, if you heard a pastor say, you want to see God? Who do you think you're looking at up here? You know, I am God. I mean, that would be the implication. Have I been your pastor so long and you don't know who I am and you still need to see God after you've seen me? You know, I mean, that'd be so brazen, so outlandish. And yet Jesus said it and no one thought it was really bizarre. No one ever thought, I mean, his disciples didn't think it sounded crazy or incredible. They didn't understand what it meant. And so he went on and said, do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? Now this is the doctrine of the co-inherence of the Father and the Son, that they are in each other. And that is, of course, something that somehow has got to inform our views of the Trinity. If we have a view of the Trinity, which I do, then we have to understand that it is such that the Father and the Son are in each other. And I could understand how a child could be in its mother, that is, in the womb of the mother, but the mother could not be inside the child at the same time, because the smaller object goes inside the larger object, but the larger object cannot simultaneously be inside the smaller object. How could the Father be in the Son, and the Son also be in the Father? Well, I suspect that since God is spirit, that we should use analogies that are more like liquid than like solid objects. And you can mix different liquids together, and they co-inhere. They are within each other. One is in the other, and the other is in that other one. So that two objects, or three, or any number of liquids can be put together into each other. And they make a blend, of course. They make a blend of something else. If you have a cream in your coffee, then the coffee is in the cream, and the cream is in the coffee. They're in each other. And they now are something a little different than either of them were by themselves. And yet, when you drink it, you can taste the part that's coffee, and you can make it out. You can say, well, this is good coffee, or this is strong coffee, or whatever. You can tell the coffee flavor by itself. And you can also tell the cream flavor. I myself like very creamy coffee, and when people serve me coffee with skim milk in it, I have no idea why anyone would put skim milk in coffee. It doesn't even change the color. But or even regular milk, even whole milk in it, it just isn't creamy enough. And I can tell when I drink a cup of coffee whether it's got creamy enough cream in it. I can, and so can you if you drink cream in your coffee. You can tell, though you've got one blend, you can make a distinction between the cream and the coffee, but you can't extract them from each other. They co-inhere. And if we understand the Trinity in those kinds of analogies, then we could say that the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit all are, as it were, one in substance, but three in distinct characters. three flavors, we might say. There's a distinction between them, but together they make one. I've always found that a lot easier than trying to picture a committee of three and say, how are these people all one? You know, how are these persons of the Godhead all one? But I think that we almost have to have something like that as our understanding if we're going to understand how the Father is in me and I'm in the Father. Unless there is an alternative, and there is, that some people have taken, and that is that it means that I am in his heart and he's in my heart. In other words, that just means we love each other. I could say that I'm in my children's hearts, or I'm in my parents' hearts, and they're in my heart. But that's not really saying anything more than that we love each other. It's not really telling you anything mysterious about us. I mean, anyone I love would be in my heart in that sense. And so I personally think that Jesus is revealing something much more difficult to grasp than just that. And that if we try to understand too well, the Trinity will probably be mixed up. Because I don't know if there's really any earthly analogy that fully works. But I, as I mentioned, have found that this verse in particular encourages me to think in terms of how the properties of liquids rather than the properties of solids. Of course, he is neither liquid nor solid. He's not matter, he's spirit. But spirit is likened in the Bible to water and to oil, in others to liquid. And that doesn't mean that spirit is liquid, but perhaps it is more like liquid than like solid, in terms of how we're to envisage how that works. It's also likened to gases, like wind, air, and so forth. In any case, Jesus is saying that the Father and I are in each other. If you've seen me, therefore, you've already seen the Father. If you've had a taste of what it's like to listen to me and to see me and the way I act, that's the Father that you're seeing and hearing. And therefore, we know that Jesus came to reveal the Father to us in his own person. And if you think of God in the Bible, and you think in terms of the Old Testament, and you think of specific stories about God, there's a good chance that you'll be thinking about stories that are maybe stories of his severity. The reason I think there's a good chance of that is because of the great number of people who bring this up to me, and ask, you know, how is it that the God in the Old Testament is so severe and so judgmental, so wrathful? And in the New Testament, Jesus is so other than that. But the truth is that the God of the Old Testament isn't wrathful. He gets angry, as even good and gentle and patient people sometimes do. But he's slow to anger and plenteous in mercy. And that's what the Old Testament says about him many times, that he's a merciful God. He loved Israel with an everlasting love, although they didn't love him back. He put up with a great deal. He's got a very long fuse. Yes, you do read about those cases in the Bible where he came to the end of his patience with somebody and had to do something to them. But parents come to the end of their patience sometimes with their children, or maybe not the end of their patience so much, as they just realize it's not doing the child any good or anyone else to leave a matter unaddressed that needs a severe intervention. And so the God of the Old Testament is sometimes mistaken to be a severe God because we read mostly of cases where his people are disobeying, and we read many cases where he has to discipline or judge. And of course, a large portion of the Old Testament is the books of the prophets, and the prophets hardly ever came except to warn that God was angry. The prophets didn't always speak, but when they did, it was usually God sent them because God was angry. And so their message is a message of God's severity. But if you read of the Old Testament and don't take into account the long periods of time between the specific stories of God's judgment, don't realize that there's hundreds and hundreds of years that he's putting up with generation after generation after generation of rebellious and obstinate and destructive people before he finally cracks down and lowers the boom on them, then you won't understand, you won't have it in perspective. God is like Jesus. And many people who are trying to envisage God picture him more like Jonathan Edwards pictured God in his sermon, "The Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God." But Jonathan Edwards apparently didn't know much about God. I hate to say that because he's regarded to be one of America's greatest theologians and philosophers of all of American history. This is at least what Calvinists think about him. And yet, his most famous sermon, "Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God," depict a God that's not anything at all like Jesus. And frankly, not even anything at all like God reveals himself in the Old Testament either. But nonetheless, Jesus was a friend of sinners. And he was patient, and he got angry at religious people who were defiling the temple and misrepresenting God to the common people. But he was gentle and patient with all, and especially even with those who were fallen people. And Jesus said, if you've seen me, that's what the Father is like. That's why Jesus came. So our misunderstandings about the Father, unfortunately, which continue to this day among people who don't read carefully, you know, only heard a few Bible stories, you know, like Richard Dawkins, who apparently has not really studied the Bible at all, but is quite sure he understands the Old Testament God as a God who's misogynistic and a slave trader and, he hates homosexuals, he's homophobic, wipes out whole populations. This is the God that Richard Dawkins describes, and he thinks he's describing the God of the Old Testament. The God of the Old Testament is the God of the New Testament. Look at Jesus and you'll see what the God of the Old Testament is like. And Jesus is not without his angry moments. Jesus exhibits anger on occasion himself. And if you want to see the most unleashed anger of Jesus in any place in the Bible, look at the book of Revelation, where you read about the wrath of him that sits on the throne and of the Lamb. Well, the Lamb is Jesus. It's the wrath of the Lamb. So Jesus is both good and severe. He's more patient than any of us would be, but he's also a perfect judge, and he will judge sin more perfectly than any human judge ever does or any human court. And so Jesus is the perfect image of God to us. And that's what he said. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. What it says about him in Hebrews chapter 1, as that book opens, Hebrews 1, verses 1 through 3, it says, God, who at various times and in different ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the world, who, being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. Jesus, he's talking about here. Jesus is the brightness of God's glory. He's the express image of God's person. In Colossians chapter 1, in verse 17, Paul said, verse 15 is what I'm looking for. It says of Jesus in Colossians 1:15, he is the image of the invisible God. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. You can't see the invisible God, but you can see the image of him that he has sent down to portray himself to us in Jesus. So Jesus can say, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And that's because the Father is in me, and I'm in the Father, and we are one. Now, he doesn't say in this passage we are one. Of course, over in chapter 10, we already encountered that statement of Jesus, where he said the Father and I are one, all in chapter 10 and verse 30. Although that statement could easily be misunderstood, it's not really talking about the nature of the Trinity. It's talking more about Jesus and the Father being on the same mission and of the same mind. But here he tells us that he is in the Father and the Father in him, so that to see him is no different than seeing the Father. And he says, the words I speak, in verse 10, I don't speak on my own initiative or my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Notice the words and the works put here together. Two things Jesus is famous for, what he said and what he did. His words and his works. And he says, neither of those things are really mine. The things I've spoken are not really me. They're not mine. They're my Father saying them. This is not the first time that Jesus said this, because there was a time earlier in John where it says the people marveled and said, well, where did this man get his knowledge? This is over in chapter 7 and verse 15. says in John 7:15, and the Jews marveled, saying, how does this man know his letters, having never studied? And Jesus answered in verse 16. He answered them and said, my teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. He says, if anyone wants to do his will, he shall know concerning the teaching, whether it is from God or whether I speak of my own authority. Now he says here to the disciples in the upper room, I don't speak of my own authority. It comes from my Father. That's why if you want to see the Father and hear the Father, just listen to me. You're hearing his words come out of my mouth. And if you see what I do, you're seeing what God does. That's what he says in the second part of that, the end of verse 10. But the Father who dwells in me does the works. The Father is doing his works through me. The Father is speaking his words through me, giving his teachings through me. Everything you can observe about me, whether it's what I'm doing or what I'm saying, is an exhibition of the Father, because he's just doing those things through me. Jesus, when he came to earth, it says in Philippians chapter 2, emptied himself. In Philippians chapter 2, it says that Jesus existed beforehand in the form of God, but he did not consider being like God a thing to be grasped. He didn't cling to that. Instead, it says he made himself of no reputation. The New King James and the King James said, actually, that long phrase, made himself of no reputation, is in the Greek just two words. He emptied himself. And he emptied himself, taking the form of a servant and coming in the likeness of men. Now Jesus, when he came to earth, he emptied himself. He was in the form of God, but then he emptied himself. That's the Greek word kenosis, and the idea of God, Jesus, laying aside his divine privileges to become man is called kenosis theory. And so Jesus emptied himself and he became a man, but everything he did and said was done by the Father who dwelt in him. And he says, and the same can be true of us. In verse 11 he says, believe me that I'm in the Father and the Father in me, okay, just like I said, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. If you don't believe me just saying so, then look at the works and see whether they are the works of God or not. Already earlier he had said, if I'm not doing the works of my Father, then don't believe me. If the works I'm doing don't resemble the things that God has always done, that are in character with God, don't believe me. But if I am, then believe that the Father's in me and I'm in the Father for the work's sake, if for nothing else. Now verse 12, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. Now, there's many difficulties with this verse, one of which is that it seems to be a general statement about anyone who believes in him. That would be everyone in this room, I trust, and every Christian who genuinely believes in him. And so if this is a statement about every Christian, then we need to understand what it is that's said about every Christian. He that believes in me shall do the same works I do, and greater works than I do. He will do the works I do, and greater works than I do. Now, the works that we often think of Jesus doing are healing the sick, raising the dead, maybe walking on water, turning water to wine. These works that Jesus did, are we supposed to be doing them? And is every Christian supposed to do them? And if these are the kinds of works he's talking about, what could it possibly mean? Greater works than these. What can be greater than raising the dead? What can be greater than cleansing a leper, opening the eyes of the blind, or walking on water? Are Christians supposed to even try to imagine things more great than these miracles and then expect to do them? I'm a long way off from even just doing those things, much less anything greater than that. And I have to tell you the truth, as I understand the book of Acts and the New Testament in general, I don't think that I will probably be doing those things, not regularly anyway. If God ever has me do any kind of a miracle in the future, it'll probably be not characteristic. It'll probably be a special event. Whereas Jesus did miracles all the time. It's from this verse and not much else that many people get the impression that all Christians are supposed to go around and heal the sick and raise the dead and do all the things Jesus did. And yet, even in the New Testament, this wasn't precisely how it was. Now, the apostles did those things. And perhaps one could argue that since Jesus is in a private conversation with his apostles, that when he says, he that believes in me, he means of you in the room, any of you, he among you who believes in me. That is, through faith, you, my apostles, will duplicate my miracles. And that is possible. I mean, the wording can be understood that way, and it takes the heat off a little bit off the rest of us. I think, well, what's wrong with me? I haven't cured one leper in my whole lifetime. And so we could say, well, this might be just to the apostles. But I don't think it'd be just to the apostles. It may indeed be primarily to the apostles, and it may extend out to others who have ministries of a similar sort. Because in the book of Acts, you do find miracles being done of the same sort that Jesus did. But almost always they're done by the apostles. I say almost because there are at least a couple of exceptions, if not three. In the New Testament, we read again and again that the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of Jesus, and great signs and wonders were wrought by the hands of the apostles. We read that Paul, when he went to Ephesus in Acts 19, says special miracles were done at the hands of Paul, so that even aprons and sweatbands were taken from Paul, from his body, and given to people who were sick or demon-possessed, and the sick were healed and the demon-possessed were delivered by receiving these articles from Paul. Now, it does say in Acts 19:11 that these were special miracles. In other words, Paul didn't do this kind of thing all the time. These weren't regular miracles. This was a special thing God was doing through Paul in Ephesus that he didn't do through Paul everywhere he went, nor through all the apostles everywhere they went. Now, Jesus did that kind of thing. We don't have him sending out handkerchiefs and so forth, but Jesus could heal at a distance. Jesus could just command that someone be healed who he never laid eyes on, who is in the next town, and the person would be healed. So even these special miracles that Paul did could not be said to be greater works than what Jesus did. Now, in the book of Acts, in addition to the apostles, there are three other known cases of people working miracles. One was Philip, and one was Stephen. Philip and Stephen were both what we would call deacons. They were of the seven that were chosen to wait on tables, but they also ended up having evangelistic and apologetics ministries backed up with miracles. We read of Stephen doing miracles in Acts chapter 6. We read of Philip doing miracles in Acts chapter 8. And then in chapter 9, we read of Ananias, a brother in Damascus, who came and laid his hands on Saul so that he could receive his sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit after he'd been blinded on the road. So those three cases, besides the apostles, are the only actual recorded cases in the New Testament of persons working miracles other than the apostles. So clearly it was primarily an apostolic work which could spill over to others if God wished. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 12, that there are many gifts of the Spirit, and one of the gifts he listed, he said, to one is given the working of miracles, to another faith, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, etc. But to one person, that is some people, the working of miracles is given. Obviously, Stephen and Philip were among those that had that gift besides the apostles. But it must have been relatively rare, even in the first century church, for people to be miracle workers and have the gift of miracles. Because Paul could speak about such miracles in 2 Corinthians 12:12 as being the signs of an apostle. In 2 Corinthians 12:12, Paul is reminding the Corinthians of his ministry among them, which was not too far distant in the past at the time of his writing. And he said, surely the signs of an apostle were wrought among you in all signs and wonders and mighty deeds. He spoke about the signs and wonders that worked as apostolic signs. In other words, proof that he was an apostle. If miracles were widely done by all kinds of Christians other than the apostles, then such miracles could hardly serve as a sign of apostleship. And while some people other than apostles, like Stephen and Philip and a few others, might have had the gift of working miracles, mostly the apostles did. It was probably primarily an apostolic thing so that they could actually speak of such things as confirming a man's claim to apostleship. Now, Jesus, when he says you'll do greater works than I've done, I don't know that he could possibly mean greater miracles than he did. Just because if you catalog all the miracles of Jesus, it's hard even to imagine greater miracles. And although there are some pretty stupendous miracles in the Old Testament that Jesus never performed, like making the sun stand still, or making it not rain for 3.5 years, or making the Red Sea part and dry land to appear. Jesus didn't do those specific things, although he didn't walk on water. He didn't need to make it split and turn it into dry ground. He could just walk on top of it. He did command the weather. He didn't stop the rain for 3.5 years, but he did stop a particular storm with his command. I mean, Jesus did just about every kind of miracle that one could imagine, except for silly things. Everything Jesus did was reasonable. Everything he did was helpful. He fed hungry people, healed sick people. The things he did either were helpful or at least symbolic in teaching some spiritual lesson, like when he cursed the fig tree.